everyone, and you are very welcome to the Warhammer Community Podcast. I am Wade Price, and once more, I get to pick the brain of the wonderful Chris Peach. How are you, Peachy?
Hi, I'm back.
I'm great, thanks. And you must have been as happy as a witch elf in a puddle of guts recently with a number of releases for some of your favourite factions for the Mortal Realms, the Daughters of Khaine and the Head Knights of Slaanesh.
There's just so much. I mean, you've got the Marathi book, and you've got the beautiful looking Shadow and Pain box set. I mean, what more can a man ask for who both likes Slaanesh and Daughters of Khaine? I mean, it's like they knew that I was their target audience, surely.
Yeah, okay, well, some of your darkest desires. You had Morgan Blade Coven earlier in the year. You're happy
with the
Warhammer Underworlds, and you've got Sniff of Head Knights of Slaanesh for the Diachasm box on the way. Okay, well, we'll get on to some of that decadence later on, I'm sure. But as there's been, as you mentioned, the Broken Realms Marathi book and Marathi getting a bit more involved in the goings on of the Mortal Realms, I'll pick your brain about Daughters of Khaine. That rhymes brilliant. Because you've been collecting them and Darkling Covens and pointy-eared malevolent elves of various persuasions pretty much since the beginning of Warhammer Age of Sigmar, haven't you?
Yeah. It was quite early days, actually, when it was before the book was out. We were doing some playtests and stuff, and we asked to just, like, do some cool random forces that didn't quite match the original alliances of the old world. Yeah. So I was like, oh, that's interesting, try something a bit different. And I remember Jervis Johnson was saying it'd be really cool to try and convert some interesting, like, beasts or creatures and stuff. So I started doing at the time would have called a dark elf collection that was mixed with undead. It was featured in White Dwarf in one of the visions, and the idea was it was a citadel of pointy-eared evil elves in the realm of death, using like necromancy magics, possibly allied with Neferata because she likes the networks of spies and stuff. So the whole kind of like sorceresses and Crone Hellebron and all that kind of element that have like their network of spies mixing with undead, I thought that'd be quite cool. So having this old idea of like painting elves allied with undead, keeping the color schemes the same, like the tones, giving them like bone-esque armor as well, so I give them like amethyst robes and bony kind of carved armor, that was fun. And that's where the witch elves started to come into the element, started building like units of witch elves, some Sisters of Slaughter, and I started doing things like Charybdis with witch elf crew, Scourge Runner Chariots with witch elf crew, the same vein as the color scheme I'd had. I just thought it was quite exciting just trying different things, and in fact I ended up doing like a weird unit of Cold One Cavalry on demigryphs. There was only three, so I treated them as demigryph knights with the war scrolls that were out at the time, but they were just Cold One knights on demigryph that just matched in quite nicely with the rest of the vibe of the army. So I was dead excited about doing that kind of stuff, and because it was all new as well, I was like, I can make up what I want, do what I want, hence why undead and elves were together.
Got a nice resonance with the world that was, the way Nagash learned evil dark magic from captured Druki dark elves.
Yeah.
That kind of brought it out into the old world, I guess, from the Nehekaran beginnings. And you got that link to Neferata potentially as well. I love the idea of looking at what could be possible in the Mortal Realms at that very beginning stage. And there is great pedigree in that world that was history and mythology. Mm. Have you ever dabbled with any of that elven stuff pre-Warhammer Age of Sigmar?
In hindsight, I wish I had. I did a lot of stuff for work. So I did, when we were doing like the original Khaine books for the End Times and the Dark Elf book at the time as well, I did a lot of stuff for work that was Darkling Coven or Dark Elf-esque paint jobs. And I really enjoyed doing them, but I think I'd obviously scratched that itch because I did it for work. And now I kind of wish I'd done it because I would have had more things I could have used that I could have just rebased and used with my Darkling Covens. But actually, you know, the thing I found interesting was having that new steer with Age of Sigmar. It made me change my approach in painting the Darkling Covens. So one of the things I started doing was actually doing like high elf color schemes on Darkling Coven units. Mm-hmm. So a couple of the units I had some spearmen, which looked like they were from Yavris or Safri, but used Darkling Coven spearmen, used executioners with Blackguard helmets to look like Swordmasters of Hoth. So, yeah, it's kind of like, they were like high elves, but spikier So the colour scheme was the same, but a little bit darker. So it was quite a nice little aesthetic to draw upon, going, oh, I might try that colour scheme, but with those models instead. Mm. And that was, yeah, so a couple of units in the collection had like that vein of the high elves as well.
And we've seen more recently with your undead Daughters of Khaine, essentially, that connection to between necromancy and evil elves, full circle again, where you had the skeleton warriors with the accoutrement of witch elves to show that dark magic still seeps into the bones of even the elves in the mortal realms.
You know, annoyingly, I wish I'd done that in the early days. It was such an obvious thing to do as well. Like, just, you know, a couple of head swaps here, a couple of weapon swaps. I even, like, adding some shields here and there. When I did the undead, some of it was old Sylvania-based undead, but because I matched it all together with the Dark and Coven stuff, I'm kind of like going back, going, why didn't I do that? It's such an obvious thing to have done.
Oh, well. Right. We'll spend another half hour talking about ideas like this. I'm sure we'll see them up on social media before the end of the week. It'll be fine. Tell me about this Hag Valkyr force. I know we've talked about it on the Warcry podcast before, but for anyone who's not heard that, what inspired you to pick up another different Daughters of Khaine?
Yeah, I can't help myself painting different Daughters of Khaine, can I? So, weirdly, it started from a piece of art I once saw by one of my favourite artists. He's not a Games Workshop artist, but he's done stuff for Workshop in the past. And it was almost like a demon, a winged demon. I guess like a succubus, I guess, is probably the best way to describe it, in like red skin with like black clothing and stuff. And I was like, I wonder if that will work on Daughters of Khaine, like red skin tone with like black accoutrements and stuff. So I just got random Daughters of Khaine model and started doing some tests and stuff. And it fit together quite nicely as a concept. So the only thing you have to play around with is like breaking those different textures up. So you've got like black leather, you've got black armor, you've got black hair. So the ways I try and solve those problems with different color schemes. But the biggest thing I've always found is when painting different skin tones that aren't what we normally used to, like dark skin tones, light skin tones, is trying to make them look like skin. So I know like the heavy metal painters, when they're doing like Tau and orcs, often use the final highlighters. They use like a natural flesh tone, like Kisla flesh or Cadian flesh, and your mind fills in and goes, yeah, that's flesh, that's organic. So the concept would be the same with doing red skin. The danger you have actually of doing that is it either looks too orange or too pink, but using like Kislev flesh and Cadian flesh as like the highlights on Mephiston Red worked really well. And you can tone it back with like a glaze or two and just to pull it into the red spectrum a bit more. But because you've used those flesh highlights, it makes it look like flesh. So I was super pleased with that straight away. That worked. And then it was just breaking all the other elements down. So the armor was like a metallic, black metallic. And through experience of doing Uruk-hai, I was using that kind of concept of doing black armor with silver chips and stuff. But then we got Iron Warriors as a paint, so that was like, I'll use that instead because that's like a nice dark iron. A wash of Norn oil and a highlight here would look quite nice. One of the things I like to do to break up like a texture as well, so it's an instant visual change without just trying to work out the highlights, is to gloss things as well. So with the leathers on this, I just painted it black and just used hard coat to make it shiny. The same thing works with my Venturini Nobles is nothing else gets glossed on those models apart from the armor. So you look and go, oh yeah, that's sort of like lacquered armor because the boots aren't glossy. They're a bit more matte and drab. So I kind of just flipped that round this time. So the leather's going to be glossy, not the armor. And then the hair was just like dark burgundies, like black hair. I think it was just a couple of coats of like Corvus Black. And then I just like went down using like Barrack-Nar Burgundy, Screamer Pink. So it's almost like got a deep burgundy wine kind of tone to it. So instantly you've got three different blacks, two obvious different textures, and one that's just a subtle kind of move from black to magenta. So once I'd worked that out, I was super pleased with it. Then start painting like things like the Canary in the set, like a couple of extra like witch elves. Yeah, I foresee me doing more of those as time goes by, and maybe it becoming another army. In fact, I'm two heart renders and two life takers away from having 10 of them, and about one figure away from having a unit of witch elves. So just adding those to the Hagnar collection is like, certainly actually, if you read the Marathi book, when she does a couple of there's a siege and an attack on the Varan Thax's Moor, which is where the Catacombs Warcry game is set. She has like several different temple cities aligned with her and fighting at different locations. So actually that would be quite cool as a collection. Not only have you got like Mahagnar, but I've got Hag Valkyrie, I've got Hag Tal over there. So yeah, I'm super keen. I have to make sure they're all based the same, but yeah, But yeah, that's where that really long story short there, Wade, was a piece of art inspired me for my Hagvale gear. And of course, a couple of lines of text in Warcry was like, yeah, let's make the city and the Bloodwind spoil. Why not?
And then Marathi came up to the Bloodwind spoil and you were only delighted. Have to fight as well. Superb. So having done an Ulguin Hagnar force to start you off and then working on your Hallow Guild Hagtile Temple, then working on that beautiful striking red and black, you know, I'm a big fan of red and black colour schemes, the red and black Hag Valkyr. Surely that scratched all of Chris Peach's Daughters of Khaine itches, right? You wouldn't have invested what other sorts of Daughters of Khaine in the Mortal Realms might look like, would you?
Maybe. Yes, all right. Yeah, you got me on that one. Again, based off a piece of art I saw a long time ago, I came up with a name, which is Kinoth Geneth. The Geneth thing is a very Drukhari term that I've seen used many times, even for Marathi's temples. I think it's been used once, but certainly from the world that was, saw like that name. So that felt kind of like, oh, I'll have Geneth in there.
Geneth was the city of executioners.
Yes.
Kinoth Geneth kind of makes me think that maybe an aspect of Kurnos went to the city of executioners for like a year abroad or a gap year or something and picked up some ideas and maybe has passed them on to these witches.
You've got it. Yeah, I mean, the Kinoth thing, you've got like Kinoth Hunter, you've got Kine, and all that kind of stuff. So, it kind of tied in quite nicely. And I'm not sure where I'm going to go with it. I've definitely got two models painted, which were just the two Witch Elf warriors from the Blade Coven Warband, the Underworld one. I just wanted to do some colour tests based on this art. And if I do Warcry or play some games, I'm going to treat them as like, because they are pit fighters. Yeah, so I imagine they've lost in some great battle somewhere. They've been captured by slavers from the Varan Spire and just dragged their sorry backsides back to the Bloodwind Spore to endlessly toil in the arenas until they die. But these two, I don't think they're going to die. I've treated them as like twins. So I think it's Naomi and Nerys that the names are, just a bit of a play on letters to make it sound more elven. That was fun to do, just doing like green skin on
green skinned Daughters of Khaine. For anyone who's not seen beautiful pictures.
Yeah. I know, who would have thought doing green skin would work, but it was very subtle as well, because I used a lot of the Plague Bearer flesh, just built that up a couple of times over a white undercoat with again flesh highlights, and then shocking white hair, gold armor with like flashes of red here and there, just seemed to work quite nice. And my favorite color scheme of all, which is Incubi Darkness, as like a type of leather. I've done that with my Hagnar collection, and it worked quite nicely with this Kainoff Geneth collection as well. But I do feel that I should honor that color scheme with a few more models being painted. I might finish my second Blade Coven set in that color scheme. I think it's only fitting. But talking about the Shadow and Pain set, you know, you get like 10 Melusai in there, 5 Kinnearai, and an Iron Scale. So why not? I like those models, so why not paint them in those green tones as well? So that'd be quite...
You're probably not far off at least a meeting engagement force. Peer force. And then you've definitely got Warhammer Underworlds or a little Warcry force. Do you remember off the top of your head what you'd get for 1,000 points of your Daughters of Khaine for Warcry with your Hagvale Kir set?
I know all I need to do really for that is to add a couple more Heart Renders and Life Takers, because at the moment I've got 3 of each in my Hagvale Kir skin Warcry force. So adding a couple more of those to it, and then I think just a handful more Witch Elves and a couple of characters like a Hag Queen, that should be around about that. I have done 2 Melusai as well, Blood Sisters, so they have fallen short on points.
So Hagtal, where does the name Hagtal come from?
So there's a couple of things. Firstly, in the Daughters of Khaine book, there was a temple city that got destroyed by Slaanesh, and if memory serves, that was called Hagtal. So I kind of took that and renamed it. Well, not renamed it. Imagined it was like a splinter force or refugees of that city, temple city, that made it to Hallowguild, my made-up city. That's somewhere in the realm of Akshi. No one needs to know. It's because I don't want it to get stomped on by orcs or chaos. But so I imagine there's like a small remnant of that temple city in Hallowguild. So, and then I thought, you know what? Actually, normally when I paint color schemes for Daughters of Khaine, it tends to be like brasses and golds and black and blood reds and, you know, all things you imagine that are very Khaine-ite. So having an opportunity to change the colour scheme because they're in this city, it matches with everything else, the heraldry and the pomp and ceremony that goes with all that kind of stuff that goes off in Haligord. It kind of made sense to do it. So, yeah, for one, having like a different visual vibe, but also using a name that had already existed. And the great thing as well is Tal is from the old world for like Talibaclan, like the god, I think it's like the tree spirit or the god of the
god of wild places.
Yes, wild places, yeah. So yeah, they're now obviously, you know, wild, if you like, mm-hmm. on their own. So a bit of a link there. But yeah,
so, I like the idea that they turned up in their original panoply and the inhabitants and the citizens of Haligord looked at them out. What are you wearing, people? Right, what are you wearing? We all wear nice clothes from Haligord. So what was the colour scheme that you chose for this force from Hag Tal?
So to match in with all the Haligord stuff, it was like white. So my colour scheme is like gold, sort of like a turquoise blue and white. Mm-hmm. So like the boots and any kind of like leathery details would be white, and like gold armor, and then like things like the loincloths or the odd accent here and there would be like that turquoise blue. So it kind of tied in quite nicely as the visual. But one of the things I like to do, because I don't want it to be too clean, got a little bit of blood and flick that on the model, so you know they're not that bothered about, you know, doing a white wash at the end of a battle because they're going to be covered in gore and visceral elements from the throats that they've opened. So yeah, again, it's that whole kind of thing of the balance of like less is more. So I kind of wanted to give the impression that they've opened a few arteries, but not to the point that they're completely drenched. Mm. And again, they tied in quite nicely. So when I had all the other units laid out next to them, it was like, yep, basin's the same, colour scheme's the same. They've all got like really like blonde, yellowy blonde hair. But again, that could be like a dye that they do to match him in that golden aspect to make themselves look a little bit more angelic than they actually are. Because they do have their own little front, if you like, the Daughters of Khaine, which is the arenas where they, you know, do fighting and people go in there and make bets and watch like these warrior women slicing up baddies. But I think there's some darker stuff that goes on behind the scenes that the inhabitants of these cities don't really know.
On a good front, they've got a good PR mission.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Witch elf units that you had as part of that Haligord collection. What other mortals were looking over their shoulders nervously at their blood spattered?
Well, there's all sorts of kind of things. So I started messing around with like head swaps off kits that you wouldn't normally imagine. So I got some Darkling Coven spearmen and gave them greatsword and outrider helmets, which kind of looked jaggedy but human at the same time. In fact, I ended up using like dwarven hammers and axes on the spear tips, so it was like a unit of halberdiers but with big hammers, so like hammerers. So there was like a dwarven weapons, elven armor, but humans inside of it. So there's this whole kind of mishmash of like different smiths in the city. So there's like some of those. I've got some elves in there, got some dwarves in there, dwarven, and then just a few humans that have like elven heads, like the wildwood ranger heads on like great swords. So there's all this kind of like mixing of different kits and stuff anyway. So the Daughters of Khaine that were in that colour scheme didn't seem too out there. Yeah. They kind of fit in quite nicely as a visual. So yeah, mixing all those kits together was great fun in the first place. I think it's on the early stages of that collection is on the Armies on Parade site. So you can see some of all the things that folks did over the years for Armies on Parade, and my army of Haligord, the early days is on there as well, which is good to see. But yeah.
When the Cities of Sigmar Battletome came out, there was an article on the Warhammer Community, I think, where some of your Haligord stuff was
of course, yeah.
Those units, yeah, that looked like there were elven smiths making the ringmail armour and dwarven smiths making big hammers for the mustachioed humans to go and fight them alongside Ben Johnson and Ricky Smith's Cities of Sigmar's army.
Yes, yeah. Yeah, of course, yeah. Yeah. I mean, that was a big move for me as well, having like that book come out. That was nice to add that. And I think that kind of really helped embolden having like Daughters of Khaine in Cities of Sigma, even though like they are their own faction, having the allies in there and vice versa, it kind of feels more like a unified order force. So I know Marathi has a bit of sort of, you know, strange looks from the other gods and the commanders of these cities and stuff, but at the same time, you know, she fights chaos quite well, and things like the Knights Excelsior are big fans of Marathi and the Anvils of the Heldenhammer have worked with in the past, going, yeah, they kill chaos well. We should work more with these. Mm. So yeah, having that kind of like link, but you know, they're still not baddies, but there's definitely a grey area with Daughters of Khaine. So having them fight against their own factions and stuff like that is quite fun as well, which is great to see in the Marathi book. I don't want to obviously give any spoilers away, but some things happen in that book which I'm like, oh.
We love a good conflict. We love a good point.
But oh, yeah.
Your Hagtile Force, just thinking of your point of less is more when it comes to the blood spatter on them, certainly in the sort of company they keep. I don't imagine humans with big double-handed hammers look like they're opening arteries themselves. So the rest of the force, as well as asking the mortals, probably don't look otherwise blood spattered. So just a little bit of arterial spray is enough to suggest that they're a little bit out there compared to their compatriots.
Well, there was a little story thread in the Soul Wars rulebook when that came out, which I love. And it was just, like a paragraph or two. And it's from the perspective of a Free Guild halberdier or soldier of the Free Cities. And he's mesmerized by the Daughters of Khaine because they fight loads of like oryx, and they're just, you know, opening arches of oryx and this, that, and the other, and like proper slicing into them. And he's like mesmerized by, oh my God, you know, I've seen them in the arenas, they're very acrobatic. And then one gets smashed in the face and then cast quite close to him by an oryx, so he like runs over to help her out. She just stabs him in the heart. It's like, yeah, don't get close when they're in a battle frenzy. That was a bad idea.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Don't get involved. She's not worth it. And roll back. What you mentioned the conversions. Do you remember any of the choice conversions that you did for that Hagtile Force to make some of the models more reminiscent of Garrick's Reavers? Yeah. Remember, what was it? Bereka's Reavers? Gareka's Reavers?
Yeah, Gareka's Bereavers or something. Yeah, so there was my names for the actual Garrick's Reavers are, I remember there's Garrick. So him, actually, that started off as the Darkling Coven Sorceress with Shadow Staff and like a little sickle coming out. But actually, I redid that pose and used one of the Hag Queens from the, well, the Hag Queen from the Cauldron of Blood set, because she's standing on a skull. And I got rid of the chalice that she's got in her hand, replaced that with a hand that's holding a skull, because, or a severed head, because Garrick's holding a severed head and I think he's got an axe in the other hand. So I used the sickles from the Canary to represent axes. And you got one with like a skull mask who's got a big double-handed axe above his head. And this is my favorite one, was using one of the Heartrender helms. So it's like the Sister of Slaughter variant of the Canary with the big horns coming out. And then used one of the glaives from the Malusi Blood Sisters, which kind of looks like an axe as well, like a big double-handed axe. So yeah, trying to get those kind of weapon options and almost the same, not quite the same pose. You're not going to get the same pose, but almost you look at it and go, yeah, that's that one. Yeah, that's that one. Is it Tarsus the Chained? Yeah. So there's one that's got chains on the blade. So that made sense, and holding the hand out as running forward. So yeah, that I can do that one dead easy. But yeah, some of the others are a bit more tricky. But yeah, it was good little bit of fun. And actually, I think my favorite mix, and I might end up doing a unit of it, is like maybe. In Marathi, it refers to a group of bodyguards, like Melusai bodyguards, called the Vipiric Guard. I don't know if they're exclusively Melusai, so I'll have to do some research on that. But I'd simply like to do some normal Witch Elf bodyguards using the Blood Sister helms that have got like the double snakes coming off the helms and the double-handed glaives. And if you stick the breastplates onto the Daughters of Khaine, that works fine as well. So doing a unit of Witch Elves with those helms, those glaives, and that like torso armor, is quite nice. It works really well, and I've done that about three or four times now with the kit, so it was quite nice to as a different visual, like special elite witch elves that were heavily armored.
I'm just minded looking at the board behind you with all of your hashtag Noblevember stuff about your Ventrillion noble.
Oh, yes, yeah. You've got
great form for that kind of just looking at different ways of identifying units that won't have any different rules in the game, but a really nice way of identifying different units of witch elves, one from another, on the tabletop, but also to give you something cool and new to play around with as a way of expressing what that particular unit might look like and having some sort of ceremonial masks on them to set them apart from the other witch elves. It's still just witch elves. It's just an opportunity to do something cool with witch elves.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's the big thing, actually, is like looking at different kits and seeing what you can do. Like we were saying with the Noble Vember stuff, like using Luminef and giving them like Skitari arms gives you a different silhouette on the battlefield, but they still tie in visually with the rest of the stuff. So doing that with like Witch Elves is dead easy. In fact, I saw quite recently someone that has done a conversion, or a few people have done conversions using Cypher Lords, giving them Witch Elf heads. It's like, well, that's different. They could be like initiates that maybe be joining the cults. So yeah, I might have a play with like doing different styles of accoutrements and clothing, just to. But of course, we've got the Khaine Shadowstalk as well now, which is such an amazing kit. So yeah, eager to get myself that set so I can start painting them up as well. But I've got a list of things to do first, Wade. I've got to get past that before I start getting more excited. It's the downside of all these releases, like Shadow Pain and Marathi coming out. It's like, oh no, I want to get all this other stuff done.
Just spend 45 minutes prodding you, much like one might prod the sleeping recumbent form of Slana, and just see what ideas might spill out of you. Maybe, you know, something might jump up the list and we might see some of this manifest sooner or later. Because I remember the Hagtile Force that you had, having used it originally to be able to play Warhammer Underworld if you wanted to, you were then building it up into a legitimate Warhammer Age of Sigmar Skirmish Force. I remember last year, before Warcry was released, Warhammer Age of Sigmar Skirmish was released as a little expansion to play around with from White Dwarf, and you were playing some games against Duncan's Caradron Overlords, a little skirmish campaign, and you went to the lengths of making a wrecked Cauldron of Blood. But I remember when you put it in the office and you took it out of the case, and I didn't realise you'd actually made a wrecked Cauldron of Blood. I thought you'd built a Cauldron of Blood and it had become damaged in transit. I was mortified and horrified, and you had to explain to me just what kind of an idiot I was, because you took great pains to model this cracked mirrors and all. That was superb. What inspired that?
I guess I've built enough Cauldron of Blood and Blood Rack shrines over the years. And I was like, you know what, have an objective, because I was really into like making objectives, because I did some for the Hagnar collection as well. I had like loads of spare bits here and there from different kits and stuff, and I was like, it'd be really good actually to have a Cauldron of Blood, because they are quite important to the Daughters of Khaine. The cauldrons themselves link to the Mother Cauldron in Marathi's chambers in Hagnar, so it's like actually they're almost like relics and they revere these things. So having like a destroyed one makes a great centerpiece as an objective for a game. And for skirmish, it was cool anyway, just like, you know, the Caradon Overlords have like gunned this thing down with a frigate. So you're there now trying to rescue or try and fix it or get it back, maybe using your shadow magics and stuff. So yeah, I mean, now that I've done that, I think it would be wrong and definitely right to do it for my Hagnar as well. Maybe a different version of it, maybe with, because this one was a blood rack shrine, because it had like the mirror on the back. And yeah, that objective was the blood rack Medusa had escaped, and you had to try and find her, because obviously the cauldron itself had been destroyed and the mirror had been smashed, so you had to get that to find where she's gone so you can use her in the skirmish games. But yeah, doing a destroyed Khaine statue would be quite nice as well. I mean, that top ward, maybe make it into several different objectives, that one kit, break it down, make it into a bunch of objectives. Like I said, I've already done some objectives for my Daughters of Khaine, which was like little cauldrons, dead bodies, icons, important little hearts. Maybe it's one of the hearts that they're searching for. We all know it's not, because Marathi's only got the one. There's no more bits of Khaine around, but she doesn't let them know that. They don't need to know that. Need to know basis. None of them need to know. She's lying to them. So yeah, just having loads of cool objectives to fight over. But yeah, doing a big one. I might do that for Hagnar, actually. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Cool. Damn,
so you. You've got a Hagnar force, and your Hagnar force includes Marathi, her own self, doesn't it?
It does indeed, yeah. It was quite a recent paint job. I'd started a while back, and then as happens in this hobby, lots of other stuff interested me, and I started painting those. And then it was, I think, before lockdown, actually, I just finished her off and had it up on my shelf up here. So I've included different elements from the different colour schemes I've done, because I've done the Hagtile stuff. I've got my Hag Valkyria, which are like red-skinned, black-haired Daughters of Khaine, which are from the Bloodwind Spoil. So I've got elements of like some of the weaponry and some of the colour schemes from those collections put into my Marathi. So it's almost like she is the figurehead of the Daughters of Khaine, so having like my different collections with like little elements that tie in kind of makes it unify them. I'm sure at some point I might do a whole army of Hagtal and a whole army of Hag Valkyr, but at the moment they're just for skirmish and warcry.
So you've painted an awful lot of different Daughters of Khaine. Do you have any kind of principles or any advice for anyone who might be starting a collection of Daughters of Khaine or painting any of these models for the first time? Anything to consider?
Yeah, I think the thing I've found as a hack is to do the skin first. So in the early stages of doing any kind of like painting, it's always picking the large majority of the model. And I certainly think with Daughters of Khaine, you've got quite a lot of skin there. So I've always found like if I'm doing like light skin tones, I would spray the model white and then just use a couple of coats of Gulliman flesh, do the highlights, because you can be really messy at this point as well. And then I'd probably say after that is do the hair. And then this is where it gets a little bit tricky, is once you've done all that, that's when you've got to be a little bit neater and like do like the armor, the cloth, things like obviously the leathers. But I initially start off with thin down paints when I do that. So if I'm like doing the black leather, I've sprayed it white, I'm doing the black leather, I might use black Templo as just a quick base coat because it sinks quite nicely where the join between the leg and the leather is on the boots. Mm. And then you've got like an almost initial kind of like tone down there that you can then just fill in the rest with a bit of black without worrying too much. But certainly if you're new to it, I would definitely worry about the skin and then pick out the other details as time goes on. And having the colors thinned down a bit more kind of almost gives you a border around sections, so you don't have to like go, oh, gotta be really neat here. If it's thinned down, it will flow into the cracks a bit more. So where the join is from like the breastplate or the boots or the gloves or the hair, you've got the crown as well. Yeah, with being thinned down, it'll kind of give you that border around those things. But yeah, they are fun to paint though. I mean, it's the thing I find when I've done all the things like the hair, the armor, although like some of the color schemes I've done, like the red one, it's not as obvious, and I've definitely chosen not to do it. But other ones, like doing war paint, like red around the eyes, or the Hag Tar ones, they've got like smeared blood around their face because they're obviously like, I don't know, ripping necks out of like their foes and like, you know, drinking their blood and stuff like that. So it's all like smeared across their face, so they don't look too pleasant when you like get too close to them. But yeah, certainly playing around with like tattoos and things on, because you've got a lot of skin surface, so you can play around with like little designs here and there. But yeah, certainly life hack for painting Daughters of Khaine, skin first.
Yeah, that kind of brings together two common painting philosophies. Sometimes people start with the thing that will have the most surface area, so you might start painting a space marine by painting all of the armor, but some people like to paint the furthest in thing, the most recessed thing first, which in the case of the space marines I'm looking at on my desk at the moment, sometimes you paint the face of a space marine before painting the armor over the top. When the skin is what is the most surface area on the miniature, you've started both of those approaches. Those painting systems will be happy. And then, yeah, a few details to finish off afterwards.
Mm. Right. Yeah. That's very, very well remembered, Wade. I'm proud of you.
Thank you. I miss a few times. Any tips for working on Marathi, her own self? Having worked on that recently.
Yeah, it's definitely in the video that I did. I certainly think having her as sub-assemblies helped me so much because the model I built, I actually built it before I did my video, so my own personal one. I was, because I was doing some plane testing with it and stuff like that, trying different colors. I wanted to mess it up on mine before I started doing it for the work one. And I glued both her wings together, and I wish I hadn't, because there's the curled one, the open one on this side, or if you're looking at the camera that side, it's easy to access, but the curled one is really fiddly. So I never, when I did the painting video, I didn't glue that one in. And just plugged it on after, and it, with a little bit of filing here and there where you might have got some paint on the joins, it doesn't influence or affect the final finish once you've glued it together. So that was definitely a thing I made sure I did. I actually didn't glue her to a base either, because she spins around that little pillar. So I sprayed the pillar Xandru dust, I sprayed her grey. So instantly, once you move it round, you do scuff the Xandru just a little bit when you try and twist it back onto the pillar. But that's a really quick fix, just like a little bit of Xandru just paint, just to tart that up and then just dry brush back over. That's super quick. And then the actual small High Oracle version, or Marathi Khaine, as she's now known. I built most of her as part of the build, apart from her head, which was sprayed black. And then I kind of masked the head off and sprayed the rest of the wing gold, and had the other wing sprayed gold as well. So I definitely found just a couple of little sub assemblies with the big lass herself definitely helped.
Put some respect on her name, Peachy. Don't call her Matthew Khaine. You're doing so well before. I remember a while ago when we talked about painting Sylvaneth, we talked about how you and the hobby team had used the tree revenants, I think, as test models for different colour schemes because they had all of the different textures and aspects that you might want to paint as a Sylvaneth player. So they're really good to make sure you've stress tested your colour scheme essentially, so you don't get surprised by something. Is there anything that's particularly good in the Daughters of Khaine range, thinking of the Melusai and the Canerai where you've got wings and scales? What's the best way to consider all of the colours that you might want to paint on your models?
Yeah, I think I would probably say the Melusai is your safest bet, because you've got the snake texture there already. You've got the skin tones of the Daughters of Khaine and like all the other elements like the crowns and helms and armor. For the wings of the Canerai, chances are you're probably going to do that same as the skin. So in some places I've like done some more red mottling on it and this, that, and the other. But yeah, I think if it was one model, you had one model, I'd probably use the Melusai as the test. Obviously it's a set of five, so if you do make mistakes, then just be careful and neatly base coat back over and try again. But yeah, I think there's a lot of textures and different elements to that one model that covers everything. And the other thing you can think about doing as well is like you will get spare heads and helmets depending on which set you've got. So if you want to like, what am I going to do for the slaughter, Sisters of Slaughter, the Heart Renders and the Blood Sisters, what should I do for their helms, and what should I do for the face and hair of like the Blood Stalkers and the Life Takers and the Witch Elves themselves? Just use a spare head of each of those and just test, because you get loads of spare heads on all those sets. So yeah, I have a couple of like little pins or paper clips with like heads on spikes set. Well, it's very fitting for Daughters of Khaine to have heads on spikes, to be fair. And then just try different like tones, and then just once you've like built your one of your models with your test colors, just try different heads on with hairstyles, going, yeah, that one works. I'm not so keen on that one. That's a quick way of certainly getting all those different pieces together, because it's dead easy to glue everything and then do your test model and go, oh, now I've ruined the hair now. But you're having a spare head or two to drop in and off can help you make those decisions.
Fine hobby hacks from Chris Peach. Storied history with the Daughters of Khaine. So which Daughters of Khaine force do you reckon you're going to turn your attentions to next? What do you reckon we might see put up on social media as the next finished paint job? More for here or more for
Kinnath Gineth, I think. I think you're right with that one. I think if I've asked and smiled sweetly at Mrs. Peach, although I'm going to order the set soon, I'm probably not going to get around to painting Shadow and Pain before Christmas, so I might have that as my Christmas present. Then I will probably paint the contents of that as Kynoff Guinea.
Beautiful. And
might do some more Witch Elves. I definitely want to finish off the rest of the Blade Coven in that colour scheme for sure. And of course there's the Shadow Stalkers as well, Wade. I need to get on them. Who do I paint them as? Oh, do I do them as Hagnar, or do I pick one of the others? Oh, there are big questions in life being answered right now on the
first set. You should probably do the first set. Yeah. That might be appropriate, but I think the second set would look really good.
Can I just say as well, kudos to the miniatures designers with the Shadow Stalkers. I don't know if you've seen the set or you built them yourselves, but you get the Shadow Queen, right, which is a cool looking model, or Shroud Queen, sorry. I do like the fact that you have like Slaughter Queens, Hag Queens, and now you've got Shroud Queens. I like this. So you get the Shroud Queen, you get all the other different types of units, so like the Warp Lock. If you have Witch Elves, Sisters of Slaughter, and Doomfire Warlocks, you've got elements of each of those in the Khaine Shadow Stalkers. But you can build the Shroud Queen as just a normal Khaine Shadow Stalker. So you can buy multiple sets and just have lots of different varieties. There's a lot of options in that box set than I realised. Kudos to the miniature designers for that one.
Well, I look forward to checking in on you soon enough and seeing what sort of magic you've wrought with them, Peachy. Thank you very much for your time and sharing some of these fine ideas for anyone who might be working on some Daughters of Khaine of their own in the future. We look forward to seeing what people have been working on. And thank you for joining us for this episode of the Warhammer Community Podcast. We'll see you again very soon. Cheers.